It's not exactly what happened at that homeschool conference. I asked, is that Corey Clark? Corey Clark, yeah, isn't he head of Catholic Answers? Think he'll talk to me? Excuse me, sir. And I was tugging on his coat. Excuse me, sir. And you know what? You were like the cool table, and I was the glee club. You redeemed yourself. I got here 4 days ago. In Canton, they told me, wait till you get to San Diego. 70 degrees, blue skies always, perfect weather for the United States. So I waited. I went to bed. I figure, well, the morning it's going to be pretty good. Woke up. Went to bed again. Figured, well, in the morning it's going to be pretty good. Woke up. Went to bed again. I called my wife. I'm from Ohio. Honey, what's it like over there? She said it's 65 degrees and sunny. I was beginning to think your little brochures were kind of fraudulent. Jesus, Moses, and an elderly-looking gentleman were golfing. Moses steps up to hit the first shot. Terrible shot. Heads straight for the pond. Moses runs up to the edge of the pond. Water parts. Ball bounces across the bottom of the pond, up onto the fairway. Jesus says, "That's a nice shot, Moses." The elderly-looking gentleman's thinking, "What did I get myself into?" Jesus steps up. Terrible shot. Heads straight for the pond. Hits the water. And sits. Jesus walks across the water. Stands. Chips the ball up onto the fairway. Moses says, "You too, Savior. Fine shot." Elderly looking gentleman's thinking, how do you compete with these guys? He steps up. Hits the worst shot of the three. 30 yards into the rough behind an oak tree where it sits. Big gust of wind comes out, blows the ball out onto the fairway into the pond where it sinks to the bottom. Big carp grabs the ball out of the mud, leaps the water and hangs at an apex for about 6 seconds till a starling comes out of the woods, grabs the ball, flies 380 yards down the fairway, drops the ball onto the green. Squirrel comes out of the woods, nudges the ball into the cup for a hole-in-one. Jesus turns, says, "That's a nice shot, Dad." I left the Catholic Church for 8 years. I wasn't mad at her. Notice how people get mad morally at the Catholic Church. It's always below the waist. Adultery, fornication, contraception, abortion, homosexuality. When's the last time you heard somebody say, "You know what I don't like about that Catholic Church? I'll tell you what I don't like about that Catholic Church. They tell you you are to take care of the poor." Who are they to tell me what to do with my wallet? "You know what I don't like about that Catholic Church, Father? I'll tell you what I don't like. They say you don't punch people in the head. Now, who are they to tell me what to do with my fist?" No, it's always down here. Have you noticed that? I left. I wasn't mad at the church. Not at all. I just drifted out. I figured God's God, Jesus is Jesus. I'm going to go where I'm nice and comfortable and where they have nice reclining, comfortable seats, not this hard wooden stuff. We had cup holders too. In a way, I was a new atheist. Now, see, the old atheists kind of make sense. There is no God. Therefore, I can do what I want. Now, if there is no God, that's logically true. I was a new atheist. The new atheists are all over the place. I mean, unfortunately, they're sitting in our pews sometimes. The new atheist says, there is a God, but he thinks just like me. I was a new atheist, so I left. I went into the evangelical world. At one point, I was in three Bible studies a week. I had a prison ministry. I got deeper and deeper into the Protestant evangelical expression of the faith, and then the trouble started. Before I go any further, dear people, I want to double underline this. This talk is not to impugn the many good Christians of other faith traditions. Many of them love the Lord so deeply they could put us to shame. It is to talk about the system that they are in. Two systems. Catholic, Protestant. We'll leave out Orthodox for now. Protestant. How do you know which one's right? You guys aren't scripture scholars, and if you go up against a knowledgeable Protestant, he'll tear you apart. Why do you pray to Mary? Well, because my grandma always did, and she's really a nice lady, and you know, she said to pray to Mary. You'll lose. How do you know? There is a very simple way to know. You ask one question. Which system does not contradict itself? Which system is coherent within itself? Let me explain. Where I was, we believed a very pillar of the Protestant traditions, sola scriptura. And sola scriptura is a Latin phrase. It just means the Bible alone, and it basically just means that's all you need. You got the Bible. You got the Holy Spirit. That's all you need. You don't need Father here. And you don't need whatever you Catholics do over there. And you don't need this up here. You just got the Bible. That's all you need. Well, okay, that's an interesting theory. Let's see how it plays out. According to the Oxford Dictionary of Christian Denominations and Independent Churches, do you know in the United States how many churches, independent and denominations, there are and growing? 35,000. How do you account for this if they're all using the same scripture? Well, the answer given to me was this. Ray, that's not really a problem. We agree on the basics. I majored in psychology and I minored in philosophy. Philosophy is one of those subjects that will screw your head up for the rest of your life. Instead of sitting there going, there's a professor up there at the front of the class and telling us how to think. No, you go, can I trust my senses? Am I in a parallel universe? Have I degenerated into solipsism? Remember that question that messed up your head? If a tree falls into woods, there's nobody there to hear it, does it make a sound? By the way, it doesn't, because it just moves air. There's a modern gender counterpart to that. If a man is in the woods, all alone, and there are no women there to hear him speak, if he speaks, is he still wrong? And the ladies are going, ah, duh. It's Lent, right? You know the definition of impending middle age? It's when your wife gives up intimacy for Lent and you don't realize it till Monday after Easter. These guys are looking at me like, what's your point, man? We know when Lent is, January 6th to August 28th. Father, when are they going to shorten up that church calendar there? So I minored in philosophy. Now, philosophy has something that is called a tautology. Something related is circular reasoning. We agree on the basics is circular reasoning. What do you agree upon? The basics. Why do you agree upon them? Because they're the basics. Why are they the basics? Because we agree upon them. It just goes in a circle. Who determines the basics? What are the basics? Where I was, we had a great selling point. And by the way, this pulls a lot of Catholics out of the church. Once saved, always saved. By the way, in the evangelical world, we had a lot of great marketing sound bites. Once saved, always saved. The main things are the plain things, and the plain things are the main things. Major on the major and minor on the minors. We have to agree to disagree. Let Scripture interpret Scripture. We Catholics have no good sound bites. We don't. How do you know that Peter was the first pope? Well, because when apostles were there at Caesarea Philippi and that big monolithic rock up there, and Jesus said, "Who do, now you lose them. You got to have a sound bite. Pete's got deceit. Don't bury without Mary. Eucharist, the host with the most. Got to have a sound bite. Once saved, always saved. What a great gig. It basically says this. You ask Jesus Christ into your Lord and Savior. You confess him as your Lord and Savior, and you're saved. That's it. You can't blow it. Boy, that's a nice thing to believe, isn't it? Is it logical? Here's the scenario. 7-year-old boy goes to Bible camp. He professes Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, and he comes home all excited. I'm a Christian, Mom. Age 17, he goes to a Billy Graham crusade. He goes down front. He again recommits his life. He feels a calling to the ministry. He goes to college. He gets a master's of divinity. He gets a small little congregation, but he's a great preacher. And it bigs. It grows. He's 43 years old. Huge congregation. Wife, 3 kids. And then a 28-year-old single woman moves in next door. She's got her emotional issues, so he counsels her. He helps her out. One thing leads to another. He leaves his wife and 3 kids. He's out of the ministry. He doesn't step back into a church. Is he still saved? The answer I got to that question, not only from my colleagues, but from some of the most high-profile Christians, makes no sense whatsoever. He must not have been saved to begin with. Oh! Then how can you have assurance of salvation if at any point you could be wrong and then you'll be told, you know, 32 years ago, you blew it. You didn't have salvation. What are the basics? I was in a Bible study with a pastor's wife where I was. And I said to her, is sanctity of life a basic? That the baby in the womb has a soul, and in fact, you can't kill it. It's a grave moral evil. And she said, of course it's a basic. And I said, then are you willing to acknowledge that much of the Protestant world doesn't agree with you? Is that a basic? Many of the mainlines believe it's a woman's choice to do this. Is that a basic? You guys worshiped that wafer in appearance. Is that a basic? Because if it's not, there's no middle ground here. It's not just something cute that you do. If that's not true, then you might as well worship an alligator head. Is that a basic or is it not? I adopted our 10 children. Can I tell them just a little bit about that, Chris? At one point, my kids were 12, 11, 10, 10, 9, 7, 4, 3, 2, and baby. All adopted. And my wife and I had an ongoing conflict as we got more children. And ladies, I think you'll agree with me. First of all, my wife does not work for a living. I don't know what she does. And you quote me, I'll deny I was here. I've seen what the woman does. I want no part of what the woman does. When the kids were little, she'd take them to a grocery store, and I'd go. If I was heavily sedated, I would go. You had to see it strung out behind her like ducks, you know, hands at their sides. Not allowed to touch anything. They would not deviate 6 inches either way out of a straight line the whole 3 hours they were in there. No, they wouldn't. Leg irons wouldn't let them. I got 3 white kids, 2 Hispanic kids, 2 biracial kids, 3 black kids. People would look at my wife. Some of them were pretty bold. It's some kind of club or something? Some of them wouldn't say a whole lot, but I could read their eyes. That major dork don't realize them ain't all his. I suspect her, but I can't catch her. So my wife was out of the Catholic Church with me, and we adopted our little son, Andrew. I said, honey, let's baptize Andrew. Now, where I was, you didn't have to be baptized. If you wanted to, you could, but it wasn't something you had to do. Is that a basic? When my grandfather died, should I have prayed for him or not? Is that a basic? What are the basics? Who determines the basics? The Bible. You know, in a lot of respects, the Bible development doesn't make any sense. Now think about this a second. Where did we get the Bible? Most people don't know. Historically, what happened was there was a lot of stuff floating around, and they had to decide which will be our scripture. So toward the latter part of the fourth century, they got the bishops together in a council, and they decided through the guidance of the Holy Spirit. Because remember now, if you don't have the Holy Spirit guiding that Bible, you don't know if you got the Bible. You just had a bunch of guys who picked out some books and said, this is what we should pay attention to. So, the Holy Spirit, according to our church teaching, guided those bishops to pick our Bible. In the New Testament, there's 27 books. Non-Catholics agree with that. They believe that Scripture has 27 books in the New Testament. We both agree. Protestant, Catholic, Orthodox. The Old Testament, Catholics have 46 books. Protestants have 39. Now, wait a minute. Here's where the logic problem kicks in. If you believe that the Holy Spirit guided those men, and now here's the objection. The Holy Spirit doesn't need men to put together a Bible. The Holy Spirit can use those pews. Okay. But will you acknowledge the Holy Spirit did that? Yes. Okay. Then you agree that the Holy Spirit got it right on the New Testament, but he got it wrong on the Old. And Martin Luther had to come along 1,100 years later and get it right. Now, I suppose you could live with it. I couldn't live with that. That didn't make any sense to me. Holy Spirit said, New Testament, correct. Protestants, Catholics agree. Old Testament, incorrect. Protestants, Catholics don't agree. Holy Spirit missed it, corrected it later. So that makes no sense to me. But I suppose you could believe it. It's what you have to believe that if you're going to say the Old Testament only has 39 books in it. I wanted to know. I was confused, dear people. I was so messed up. I was this close to leaving Christianity. I was in a kitchen one day, and my wife and I were talking. Now, gentlemen, here's a little communication thing I just want to tell you because I'm highly trained. If the women are telling you, you are not sensitive enough, you are not emotional enough, when you talk about these heavy issues, here's what you do. Do what I did. Quietly turn around and yank about 6 nose hairs. What happens is your eyes start to water. They do. You know, you don't look blubbery. You know, you look blubbery, you look fake. But just a little bit of rim right here like this. And your wife goes, oh, that's so precious. It does matter to you, doesn't it? Well, in fact, I said to my wife, I don't know what to believe. As I told Chris, my first year in college was in engineering. You know, in engineering, you can't agree to disagree. You have your formulas and I have my formulas, okay? We just have to agree to disagree because one of us has the wrong formulas and the bridge falls down. And I thought to myself, okay, wait a minute. If Christ came, and if he was God, and if he taught us, what do I believe? Can I kill a baby or not kill a baby? can I divorce my wife and remarry? Which where I was, it was okay. They said God doesn't like that, but it's okay. You don't lose your salvation if you leave your wife and you remarry and you leave your wife with the 5 kids. That's not right. You shouldn't do that. It'll hurt your Christian walk, but you don't lose your salvation. I was a mess. I was too logical to think, what is this Christian thing? You can't figure it out. It's kind of mushy. It's kind of squishy. I remember the last time I cried. It was when the Cleveland Browns called a draw play on 3rd and 12 in the playoffs. I couldn't believe that. I said, I can't believe they did that. This is the playoffs, man. Oh, I was a mess. I didn't know what to believe. I figured, is there a way to know? There is. We have hundreds of pages of writing from the early church. Guys that knew the apostles. Polycarp knew the apostle John. Ignatius, 40 years, the disciple of the apostles. These guys knew the apostles. And they wrote. And I read. And I went, this was back when This Rock was the magazine of Catholic answers. And I said, okay, I want all the first 9 years or whatever many years it was. I bought them all. I said, I got to read. I got to see if this Catholic church makes more sense than where I am. Because where I am was messing me up. I said, I want to believe, but I don't know what to believe. Is there a way to know what to believe? So I went back and I read and read and read and read. They baptized babies. They confessed sins to a priest. They thought the bishop was Rome, was the preeminent bishop. They prayed for the dead in the catacombs, scratched into the walls of the catacombs. Remember my dearly departed mother. All the stuff that I was told where I was added on by you Catholics. The simple Christian message, you Catholics added all kinds of stuff that don't belong there. And I looked and I saw that it was either there in full or in a bit of a seed. It was there. I couldn't believe it. I thought, this is what I was told was added. And it was there. I was in a Bible study once, and there was a lady in there that was very anti-Catholic. And we were talking about this one part in the Gospel of John, where it says, you must be born again of water and the Holy Spirit. And I asked her, do you think the early church baptized? And she said, no, I don't agree with that. And I said, okay. If St. Peter were sitting in our Bible study, and she said, we're all saints. I said, okay. If Mr. Peter were sitting here in our Bible study, and by the way, you can't say St. Patrick. It's Mr. Patrick to you, please. Could he tell us whether the early apostles baptized babies or not? She said, I suppose he could. I said, would you believe him? She said, that depends. I said, that depends upon what? If he's being true to Scripture or not. Now see, to us that sounds ridiculous. But to her, she had the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit trumps Mr. Peter. See, that's where your logic will take you. I remember listening to the radio once. I was driving through McDonald's. You know, I'm old enough to remember when hamburgers were 15 cents, and a Coke was a dime, and French fries were 12 cents. I know this. They had potatoes when I was a kid. They did. There was 55 candles on my birthday cake, and that was a piece I had. Thank you, Chris. I appreciate you laughing at that. I said, you folks believe that in there is the God of the universe. I used to do evaluations for state psychiatric institutions. And a lot of times, parents would bring in a son or daughter at age 19, 20, 21, 22. And that's really the most common time that a psychosis hits. And a psychosis is a blatant loss of contact with reality, to simplify it. They would bring in their son or their daughter, and I would interview them to see if they should be committed. Now, when you're not thinking clear, much of the time you're not totally unclear. So that young person would recognize, I better watch what I say to this guy. I better not sound too crazy because I don't want to be put in here. So I would interview him. And he would make sense. I'm thinking, well, I don't know why they brought him in. He sounds pretty clear to me. And then I asked him one more question. Anything else you want to tell me? Yes. What's that? Did I tell you I'm God? The interview went on 1 minute too long. Those of you who have relatives who are in the very earliest stages of dementia. In dementia, in the early stages, it's a little tricky to kind of figure out what exactly is going on. You get some wobbly personality changes, but the person that is moving into dementia knows they don't want to look like there is cognitive slippage here. My mother-in-law lived near us. She got to be about 75, and my wife and I would go visit. My wife went every day. Every single day, Mom was sitting reading the paper when we walked in. Same chair, same table, the paper. She looked like she was with it. One day I said, hey, Ma, what's that word mean? Ray, isn't that weird? That's a weird word, isn't it? And it was the most basic word you would know. And my wife and I said, and Mom's trying to hide it, but she's starting to slip. But in the very earliest stages, it's hard to tell. They used to think memory, I don't want to digress too much, but they used to think memory was the first sign. Sometimes it is, but you know what often is? Personality changes. My grandmother is Italian. And my grandmother, when I went over there, if she didn't ask me if I was hungry every 7 seconds, something was wrong. And one day my grandmother told this filthy joke. And she laughed and she laughed. And I thought, Mama would never do that. Mama would never do that. Uh-oh. Tell you one more thing and then I'll move back. My grandmother was in a nursing home. She was 96. She was gone, totally gone. There was no communication. There was nothing. My father died when he was 76. The nursing home was just down the street. So that night, I went up to the nursing home, and Mama was just sitting there, gone, just gone. And I said, Mama, I just want you to know Nikki passed away. Nothing. Nothing. No reaction. Nothing. The nurses later told me that night she woke up very agitated, kept saying, something bad happened, something bad happened, something really bad happened. There was emotional memory still way down in there. She didn't know how to interpret Nikki passed away, but something resonated down in there. Now, I digressed a little bit, but it's going to relate to what I'm talking about. The Catholic Church has a very unusual idea. Where I was, they said, it is nothing but a memorial meal. You Catholics make way too much out of it. It was meant to be a memorial meal. Do this in memory of me. Well, you got to know the early translation because memory meant make real again. But that aside, they said, one of the big arguments they said was this. Don't you have senses? Can't you see that is a white wafer? Are you going to deny your senses? All right, I hope I got a quarter here. Somebody have a quarter? I didn't. What Catholic Answers is paying me, I don't have anything. No, what they're paying me, they're lucky they're getting verbs. Thank you, dear. All right, I need a pretty tough-looking dude here. This guy's pretty strong. Hey, sir, would you do me a favor on this quarter? Would you bend that in half for me? Would you? Show off in front of your girl hair. Now, you can't bend that in half, can you? Why not? Why can't you bend this in half? Look, it's a 16th of an inch thick. How can you not bend this in half? That's right. You're not. He goes, I'm not Superman. That's true. But it's also solid metal, right? Solid metal. You're totally wrong. I'll explain that in a second. Sir, put that right there. Is that just sitting there? Yeah, top of the thing? Yeah, you're totally wrong. If this quarter were at the equator, it would be moving 25,000 miles an hour. The Earth is moving around the sun much faster than that. The solar system is vibrating through the galaxy even faster, and the galaxy is moving through the universe even faster. Scientists have calculated that this quarter, which is sitting there like that, is moving approximately 500 miles a second. Can you see that? Can you see that quarter is moving 500 miles a second? No, no, not relative to where you're at. That's right. This guy's an engineer. But that's not the most mind-numbing thing about this quarter. What is this quarter composed of? Elementary particles. Atoms, right? When I was in college, we only had to learn electron, proton, neutron. Well, now we know there are just dozens of subatomic parts. Does anybody know how fast the electrons in the countless trillions, 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 trillions of atoms which make up this quarter are vibrating? Does anybody know? Very fast. Yeah, 60 miles an hour. Approximately approaching the speed of light. Does anybody know what the speed of light is? That's right, sir. 186,000 miles per second. Can you comprehend anything in this space moving 186,000 miles a second? You think this quarter's solid. You're wrong. It's all space. It is completely space. If you distilled it down to the actual amount of matter in this quarter, you couldn't see it. Everything around you is space. So, sir, next time your wife says, do these pants make my butt look big? You just simply say, no, honey, your butt's all space. And by the way, just a little tidbit, gentlemen, if you ever get a question like that, I don't care what you answer. If you hesitate for one fraction of a second, you're a dead man. Answer the question before she's even done. Do these pants know? Do you trust your senses now? You don't know what this quarter is. The very substance of this quarter is completely beyond your senses. You are being bombed by photons from the sun. Countless, countless, countless photons are zooming through your body right now. You don't feel them. Radio waves. All kinds of radio waves are all around you. You don't have anything to pull them down, so you can't hear them. You trust what you're looking at now? So when you look at that consecrated host and you say, well, I'll tell you what, it looks like a consecrated host to me, but I guess the church says it. I'll suppose I'll believe it. No, you've got actual physical reason to believe it because you don't know what it is. You want your quarterback, honey? Chris, would you make this quarter up? I'll put it on my expense list there. So. Thank you, sweetheart. Sometimes I would tease my Protestant friends. I'll say, okay, if I go to the early church writings and I find out 25 writings that said this is not a memorial meal, this is, in fact, a miracle left to us by Christ. And by the way, I'll paraphrase Ignatius. He said, have nothing to do with the heretics, for they do not confess that bread and wine become the very body and blood of our Lord and Savior. Irenaeus said, how could Jesus, at the Last Supper, take himself into his own hands. But he acknowledged if he wasn't God, he couldn't do that. So I would tell my Protestant friends, I tell you what, if I find 25 of those early church writings, would you consider looking at the rest of the Catholic faith? If you find one that says it's a memorial meal, I'll look back at the non-Catholic Christians. I haven't had any takers for that because that's not the reason. All right, sir, I'm trying, in the early church, I'm trying to convert you. And I'm telling you, sir, we hung around with this guy. He was amazing. I'll tell you, he could do things, miracles. And he rose from the dead. We saw him. We touched him. He rose from the dead. Now, she's looking at me, and she's thinking, okay, keep going. This is an interesting story. He's looking at me like, yeah, pal. Okay. Yeah, all right, pal. She says, anything else? I said, well, yes, ma'am. He left us a moral system, and it works. You wouldn't think it would work, but it works for maximum happiness. He's thinking, well, if my wife's going to be happy, all right, I'll take that one there. I'll use it for what that's worth. Anything else? Yes, here's my selling point. Anything happens to you, we take care of her. She goes into our community. We'll protect her. We'll protect your kids. She won't be on the street. She won't be destitute. She's with us. Now he's getting real close to being sold, and he says this. Anything else? Yeah. Whew, I don't know quite how to say this. I know it sounds kind of funny. We have bread and wine, and now we have certain appointed people. And when they say the prayers that he left us, it becomes him, and we eat him. The interview went on 1 minute too long. Who's going to make something like that up? You're trying to start a new religion. You're going to go around telling people, oh, yeah, by the way, we got to eat him. You don't do that. Leave it out. Just leave it out. Wouldn't it be nicer to say it's a memorial meal? We can all sit together, sing kumbaya, and have a happy family. But they were only doing what our Lord said. One other point about this. At what point did the second person of the Blessed Trinity biologically become human? What point? Yes, the incarnation, the conception. All right, stop the tape. Take that one-celled zygote out of the fallopian tubes of the Blessed Virgin. Put it underneath a microscope and look at it. Would you say, look at that. I always wondered what God looks like. He looks like a cell. Wow, adenine, guanine, thiamine, cytosine. That's really cute. Moving pretty good there, too. Probably ADHD. I don't know. You'd see a cell. That's why when Jesus gave the Sermon on the Mountain, he had to stop and go to the bathroom. You figure the religious leaders went, you know, there's God going to the bathroom behind a rock. I mean, they couldn't wrap their head around this. But how is that any different than saying our consecrated host is the God of the universe? It's not any harder to believe that a one-celled zygote is the God of the universe, is it? But Protestants believe that. One more thing brought me into the Catholic Church. In the 1960s, there was a huge movement. Too many people on the earth. We're going to run out of everything. And you Catholics are among the worst because you're sucking up the rainforest with all your kids. By the way, have you noticed the morals in our culture? You can have sex anytime, anywhere, anyhow you want it. The only time we'll give you grief is if you're a married woman that has more than 1.86 children. Then, Mrs. Staples, we abuse you. Isn't that interesting? If you run up against anybody who thinks there's too many people on the earth, you ask them one question. How are you so sure you're not one of the too many? You know, everybody wants everybody else to check out, not me. I'm not sucking up my share of the rainforest. So there was a lot of pressure on the Catholic Church. She was standing strong against artificial contraception. So the Pope, as popes do, decided he's got to pray about this and be guided by the Holy Spirit, put together a commission. And I think the numbers on that first commission was about 19. His original request was, will you please help me to teach this to the faithful, because this is the one place where they're starting to drift away, and we need some help here in teaching this. This is a tough teaching. Somewhere along the line, that commission, composed of ethicists and clerics and medical people, grew. I think towards the end, it was like 60-some people. And it got hijacked. It came out, and it said to the Holy Father, we got to change this, you know. We got to change this. We're way behind everybody else. The earth can't sustain this many people. By the way, just wanted to tell you one thing about how wrong people are in predicting. Over 100 countries now in the world have negative birth rates. That means the average woman needs 2.1 children to replace herself, the generation. The U.S. is now, for the first time ever, below 2.1. Italy is 1.2. There comes a point where you can no longer correct. It takes a couple generations of that low, low birth weight reproduction, and it's too late. Your population gets too old. You can't replace. This is happening in Japan. They're paying people to have babies. China, too. This is happening there. So just goes to show you the prediction that we're just going to bury the earth in people. Well, yeah, if it continued the way it was, but nobody had enough God foresight to go, things are going to change here, and people are going to stop having kids for all kinds of reasons. And that's what's happening, except the Staples. You guys are single-handedly kind of, you know, balancing out everybody. So given that, the Pope prayed, and he came out, and he sent a nuclear warhead through the Catholic Church. He wrote something called Humana Vitae, of human life. And in it he said, we do not have the power to change this teaching. This teaching comes straight from the apostles. And furthermore, if we were to change it, women would be demeaned. There would be a general coarsening of morals. Marriage would be devalued, and abortions would increase. Oh, man, all the smart people in the world looked at this and said, this is why you don't let an old man into your bedroom. He doesn't know what he's talking about. They didn't know this at the time. They know it now. The pill can be an abortifacient, which means it can work to kill a few-day-old baby. What happens is the pill isn't perfect, especially in the doses they use now, in lower doses. And sometimes, a certain percentage of the time, an egg drops, even when you're on the pill. That's why there's pregnancies on the pill. Egg drops. If it's fertilized, it heads down the fallopian tubes 3 or 4 days more, and it lacks into the uterine wall to start to grow to be a baby. The body thinks it's pregnant because the pill is faking the body out. It washes out. So you basically have a 3, 4, 5-day-old abortion. Now think about this. The Catholic Church has a teaching that really ticked off the people where I was, and I didn't understand it, why they would get so mad. The church says that Jesus, God, the Holy Spirit, will protect the church from teaching error in matters of faith and morals. Now, my Protestant friends did not like that at all. Who do you think your Pope is? And I wanted to say, how is that any different than you? Because you think the Holy Spirit will lead you to a proper interpretation of Scripture. So you got millions of popes. We ain't allowed to have one. They didn't know this. They didn't know it. They know it now. They didn't know it then. So you see what would have happened? We'd have had the Catholic Church contradicting itself. It would have said, Life begins at conception. Oh, by the way, if you hear any of our high-profile people saying we don't know when life begins, they did a survey of 5,000 PhD biologists, and they said, and they weren't Christian, probably the majority were not Christian, they said, when does life begin? 96% of them said, at fertilization. Follow the science. So, you'd have the church saying, life begins at conception. We give you permission to take a chemical. In some unknown percentage of the time, will kill that life. Up until 1930, pretty much every Christian church, Catholic, Protestant, Orthodox, said, contraception is a grave moral evil. Since then, most of the non-Catholic churches have changed their teaching on this. Okay, I got a question. If, in fact, they were guided by the Holy Spirit, and they said it was a grave moral evil, not a piddly one, a grave moral evil, and they've changed that, did the Holy Spirit change his mind? Was he wrong then? Right now, or was he right then, wrong now? Catholic Church is the only one who didn't budge, even though the whole culture says you people are lunatics. Moral consistency. For me, that was the last step to come back into the church. There's only one reason to be Catholic. Not because you like the priest. Not because that Stations of the Cross was beautiful. And by the way, that's what my wife got for penance. She went to confession when she was 39 for the first time. She was converting to Catholicism. And I said to her, I said, honey, what'd you get for penance? And she said, well, I got a rosary. I said, rosary, that's not bad for 40 years of pagan muck. She said, with the Stations of the Cross at every bead. I said, oh, okay. She asked me what I got. I said, me, most of the time? Half a sign of the cross. Sometimes a quarter. That's hardly enough time to levitate. There's only one way you can really be wrong and know you're wrong. Let's say you say there is no God. And you're right, you die. But you don't know you're right because you're dead. Let's say you say there is a God. And there's not. You die. And you're wrong. But you don't know you're wrong because you're dead. Let's say you say there is a God and you die. And you're right. There is. The only way you can be wrong is, and know you're wrong, is if there is no God and you die and there is. Oh, man, they told me this was all nonsense in college, man. How many planes went down on 9/11? 1 went into the Pentagon and the Shanksville, Pennsylvania, 2 into the towers. How many airplanes are in the air on an average air flight day? Tens of thousands, probably 40, 50,000. If somebody would have told you that morning, your son or your daughter or your grandson or your granddaughter, if they get on a plane, they have approximately a one in 10,000 chance of dying. Would you say, 1 in 10,000, come on, man, that's pretty far odds. Yeah, get on. I haven't met a person yet who said, I would tell them, go ahead. Not once. Why not? Because your daughter or your granddaughter's life is so important that you wouldn't take a chance on those odds, even how long they are. So I ask people, what odds do you want to take on this God thing? On this Christ thing? 1 in 10,000 that he doesn't exist? 1 in 50? 1 in 2? See, in gambling, you always measure it against the stakes. What are the stakes? Infinity. That's a pretty big stake. So you're going to need really, 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 really big odds to go against that stake. I'm back in the church, and I've had the good fortune over the years to be with Catholic Answers. I've really molded them into what they've become. They really were struggling in the beginning, but I had to do a lot of work. And I got the chance to be in the church. When I did my early parts of my career, I used to do secular media. I was on hundreds of radio shows. I did Oprah multiple times, just pretty much every national show you could think of. And nothing ever came of them. I thought I'd get my own show. Didn't happen. And I remember when I was leaving the church and I was messed up, I begged God. I begged him. I said, please, all I want to do is believe. Like my grandmother, I just want to believe. Help me believe. You said if I asked, you would, and it wasn't happening. God knew me better than I knew myself. He knew I was going to go after answers. See, many of your children have left the faith. And part of the reason they've left the faith is because they have questions, but they didn't seek answers. I couldn't live like that. I couldn't say, well, I have questions, therefore God's questionable. I have questions, therefore I better find answers. And I did for several years, studied, read, listened. I had no idea I was going to be on radio and TV in the Catholic world. None. So when people call me, I'm not knowledgeable like Tim. I'm not knowledgeable like many of the people over at Catholic Answers. But I know enough to answer some of their doubts. I had a guy today call. He said to me, I'm looking to come into the Catholic Church. I'm 75 years old. How do I know what I have to believe? If I read your catechism, do I have to believe every word in there? And I said, no, just my books. Now I can answer some of those questions. I can talk to people who have doubts. I had the same doubts. So God knew. He said, Ray, I'm going to let you struggle because I know how you're going to approach this. You're going to go after it. And I did.